All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. And thank you, especially with the rescheduling, because of all that wonderful snow that we had. We're really happy you could join us tonight. We really appreciate that. My name is Andrea Capelli, and I am the program coordinator for Lush Valley Food Action Society. So this evening, I'm going to talk a little bit first about what it is that Lush does, in case you've never heard of us and are wondering what all of this is about. And then we'll talk a little bit about why urban agriculture, what this project is. We'll introduce the panelists, and then we'll get to the forum discussion, and then that will be followed by a Q&A. So just a few housekeeping items to begin with. Of course, you guys know the drill with cell phones and all that jazz, so we'll keep it nice and quiet. Washrooms are just outside to your right. You probably saw them as you came in the door. And somebody left this book up at the front, so if this is yours, you can claim it after. Mystery book. I also want to acknowledge that we're on the traditional unceded territories of the Comox First Nations. That's very important to us. So for those of you who may not know about Lush Valley, we are a local not-for-profit that focuses on issues of food security within the Comox Valley. And we really like to do projects that educate and empower people to choose healthy food, to grow healthy food, and to learn and interact with their healthy food. So that's a little bit about what we do. Our mission is to increase food security in the Comox Valley through education, outreach, and advocacy. We are an island health food security hub, and we work very closely with other organizations in BC, on the islands, and even across Canada on issues surrounding food security. We offer several different programs. We really like to focus on healthy food programs and literacy, so teaching people about healthy food, how to cook, how to budget, how to grow. Some of our programs are after-school cooking programs. We do community kitchen programs where people can come and learn about canning or foraging or anything that has to do with our local food system. Linda Smith, who's here today, has been doing some really wonderful workshops for us with canning, and they've been really successful. So you can always follow us on Facebook to find out about those sort of courses or sign up to our quarterly newsletter as well. We also focus on fresh food distribution. You may have heard of our fruit tree program. It's a program that runs in the summertime where we glean people's backyard fruits, our team of almost 200 volunteers, and we redistribute that fruit to the volunteers, get a third, the homeowner gets a third, and then the rest gets distributed to other community organizations, so the food bank or local churches, schools, you name it. And then we also run an urban agriculture initiative. And this program this evening is a part of that initiative. We also have a community garden on 6th Street in Harmston in Courtney. So that's a place where anyone can have access to grow their own healthy food. So those are just, it's a really quick snippet of some of the things that we do work on in the Comox Valley involving food security. So why this project? Why are we here this evening? What was it that sort of triggered Lush to work on something like this? Well, Lush has been working on urban agriculture awareness for over 15 years now, and we've been trying to promote the value of local food security. So this evening, and with this project, we're proposing that beekeeping, keeping hens and yard gate sales, be permitted in residential neighborhoods within the city of Courtney, where these activities currently aren't allowed. We are collecting as much feedback as we possibly can from the community. We're doing that through the forum this evening, as well as two community consultations, one tomorrow and one on Wednesday, which I'll talk a little bit about in a second. And we also have an online survey, which was just released today, where you can provide your feedback on these issues. So we're going to be uncovering a lot of the why this evening. That's why we're here, is to hear from our panelists and to hear your questions and uncover and get excited about urban agriculture. So why urban agriculture? It's a growing movement that's happening across North America and the world right now. And it includes a wide range of activities that promote public participation. So the production, the sale, and the distribution of food. Until recently, a lot of families grew their own food. They had backyard gardens, they lived on farms, they were actively producing their own food. And after World War II, we really lost touch with that. People started moving to urban areas, and food as a commercial product started to increase as a practice and concept in the world. Today, as you know, our food often travels thousands and thousands of miles to reach our plates. This can reduce the freshness of what we're eating, the taste, potentially the nutritional value. It adds to our carbon footprint, and it undermines our local food security. So by relocalizing food production, communities regain some control over what they eat and how it's grown. And after the snow that just happened, there was an article that came out in the CBC about the closure of the Coquihalla Highway. And we've all heard this statistic too with Vancouver Island, is that once that highway was shut down, the food was flying off of grocery store shelves, and they said it would last at maximum 5 days, but likely about 3 days. And those statistics are quite similar for Vancouver Island. So it's really important to bolster our own local food economy. So growing your own food improves your diet. It's a social activity. It's a healthy thing to do. It empowers people to take control of their food, to know where it's come from. Everyone gets a sense of pride of growing their first tomato. It's like, yes, I did it. It's therapeutic, and it really helps to bring communities together. So those are some of the ways that urban agriculture can help to improve our society. And again, we'll get into that. So I just want to touch base also quickly on ways to get involved in urban agriculture after this evening. So after this forum, we will be holding two community consultations, one tomorrow at Lake Trail Community School in their community room. It's a lot of community, from 6 to 8 p.m. And this is a chance for you to talk to the project collaborators, to see examples of what other municipalities have been doing across Canada, and to just give us some feedback and have a conversation more than what we're able to this evening. And then we're also holding another community consultation on Wednesday at Mark R. Isfeld High School in their library, again from 6 to 8 p.m., and we encourage you to come to either one of those consultations to chat with us and tell your friends, tell everyone. And then, of course, the other way to get involved is through the online survey. So we've just released an online survey about these urban agriculture initiatives, about backyard beekeeping, hens, and yard gate sales. So we're really looking forward to hearing your feedback about that. And if you decide to, you can leave your email address to be updated on what's going on with the initiative that we're working on, and you'll be entered to win this lovely food basket full of local goodies from the Comox Alley Farmers Market. And the survey will be on and available from today until March 15th. So again, tell everybody. So, we'd love to continue the conversation with you guys through Lush Valley. You can follow us on Facebook, on Twitter. You can email us. You can call us. Set up an appointment to have a chat. We want to get as much feedback as possible, and we want our community to be involved in this process. So I'm going to just pass the mic over to Nancy Gothard from the City of Courtney, and she's going to talk a little bit about the Plan H project.
Thanks, Andrea. So, yes, my name is Nancy Gothard. I'm environmental planner at the City of Courtney, and I'm just going to say a few words on the city's role, because you probably noticed that the City of Courtney logo is part of this. It's referenced. The city applied for a BC Healthy Communities Plan H grant, And the purposes of these grants are, Plan H and BC Healthy Communities is a program from the province. And I'll just read something directly off their website. The Plan H program supports local government engagement and partnerships across sectors for creating healthier communities, recognizing that community policy, plans, and decisions affect health and well-being. Plan H provides learning opportunities, resources, and leading-edge practices for collaborative local action. So truly, collaboration and partnerships is a part of the work. After the city, Lush approached the city and said, we want to work on this project. The city endorsed that. We applied for it. And then other partners came out of the woodwork. NIC and a class of students worked on the survey, did some background research on what other communities are doing around these regulations. So it was really nice to see the partnerships truly developing. This is the third such grant that the City of Courtney has applied for and obtained. And the other two grants have gone to the Share the Harvest Community Garden that Andrea talked about on Harmston and 6th Street there. But when Lush came to the city and said, let's look at land use regulations, planning staff felt that it was an appropriate time to be looking at this, because we do get questions sometimes, people saying, you know, other communities are having hens and bees, and can we do this too? So while this is not a council-directed project and city staff do not have this officially in their work plan, we are excited to see the outcomes of the consultation. So we're definitely supporting the consultation process. I'll just remind people, this is a really great handout at the front. Please take one. Take one for your friends if there's some extra. And on it, it has the website for the survey. And I'll just give a personal stat I always want to beat in terms of survey response rate is the food truck survey that the City of Courtney did in the summer elicited 1,023 responses. And I just thought that was like the most we ever got. And then, so if we can get, like, you know, somewhere around that, maybe more on this particular one, I think council will pay attention. So there's no timeline. In other words, I just want to confirm there's no timeline about when these regulations might actually be officially considered by the city, but it is very helpful data, and the more that people are showing enthusiasm, I think it goes to show the value of this in this community. So that's all I have to say about that. And I think, Andrea, you know who comes up next.
Thank you, Nancy. So we are going to move forward with the forum, and I'm going to introduce everyone. So our moderator this evening is Jen Rye. She's a professor of sociology here at NIC, and as mentioned, her and her students have worked on the survey, which has been a great partnership for us to have with the college here. So she will be moderating, and we have Linda Smith. She's the owner of Lawn to Food and Lawn to Food Urban Farm Stand here in Comox. Linda's been involved with many urban food growing projects, especially teaching people to grow food in their own gardens. She recently competed on the Food Network cooking show Chopped Canada, woohoo, where she was able to nationally spread the benefits about growing food in your own garden, so to grow your own food. Currently at her house in Comox, she grows food in her front and backyard, often giving garden tours and advice to passerbys. And her small space allows she can grow enough produce to sell to the neighborhood through yard gate sales. So she's got a lot of experience with that. And we have Andrea Shaw. She's the principal owner of AEL, Agroecological Consulting. And she's also a professional agrologist with over 11 years of experience in the food system and agricultural land use planning, sustainable agricultural promotion, organic certification, and food security. Her AEL has worked on agricultural area plans, it's a mouthful, for the District of Saanich, City of Kelowna, Southern Gulf Islands, Regional District of North Okanagan. I can go on and on and on. She was also the executive director of Life Cycles Project Society in Victoria, which is an urban agriculture not-for-profit, and she brings a wealth of knowledge on urban ag and food security from around the province in her hometown in Comox. And we have Judith Walker. She is a senior planner with the Village of Cumberland. Judith is a registered landscape architect and planner who's lived in the Comox Valley for over 30 years. She's worked in private practice in an architecture and engineering firm and also in local government. She's always quick to point out that she was a passionate gardener long before she became a landscape architect. She and her husband have a 2-acre organic vineyard, 50 fruit trees, 5 acres of protected forest, 3 cats, a dog, and a large organic vegetable garden. And I just found out that she's also my next door neighbor, which is pretty cool. Well-meaning friends suggest she could automate more garden chores, and she laughs and says, but it's the only place I want to be. And finally, we have Linda Nagel from, she's the program coordinator at the City of Campbell River. And she is the program coordinator for parks, outdoors, and special events. She's worked in the field of parks and rec for over 20 years. And she spent 7 years doing research at UBC and has worked at the regional district of Strathcona. She also has extensive experience in special event organization from the Vancouver Marathon to off-road triathlons. And her position came about as a result of community consultation and the Sustainable Official Community Plan in Campbell River. This reflects the trend towards outdoor recreation, sustainability, and connecting to nature by getting our hands dirty. And Linda works with community groups to develop community gardens, urban orchards, and to enhance food security and local gardening knowledge. So we have an awesome panel here tonight, and I'd like to give them a warm welcome.
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Andrea. So we're going to get started. The way this is going to work is I'm going to ask a couple of questions. I'm going to start with a little bit of structure that will be directed to our esteemed panelists, and then I'm going to let them talk amongst themselves. They will stop about 8:05. We'll open the floor to questions or comments from audience members, and we'll give you a microphone and ask that you please, for our recording purposes, speak into the microphone with your question. As much as possible, please be succinct, and if you can, direct your question to a particular panelist or to everybody so we know who should answer. So I'd like to start first with Linda Smith on my left here. And going down all the way through the panel, can you please talk a little bit about the benefits of agriculture and urban agriculture practices like bees and hen keeping and yard gate sales in an urban environment?
Thank you, Jen. Well, for myself personally, that's what I'd like to speak on because that's what I'm knowledgeable in. It's just on our very small piece of property and what those benefits have been. I think that my husband and I have grown food for over 20 years. We had 3 kids and not a lot of money, and it was very, very valuable to be able to grow our own food before we moved to Vancouver Island. And we carried on that once we came here onto this under a 1/4-acre lot. And especially growing in the front yard. Once we started growing in the front yard, because the backyard was so shady, we moved to the front, we started interacting with our neighbors. And it's the first time, we're 50. We really interacted with our neighbors and got to know everybody. The dog walkers, the kids coming running through, picking blueberries off the vines. It's been a very, very valuable experience in the last 4 years we've been growing in the front yard. So I think that's my most valuable takeaway experience. First of all, being able to do it in the front yard. There are no rules or regulations against that in Comox. So just being allowed to do it is very important. It adds, we know exactly where our food is coming from. I know what's gone into the soil. It's not any chemical additives or anything along that. Our grandchildren are learning all about food, where it comes from, how you pull a carrot out of the garden, or our grandson was up on the screen getting potatoes off of the boulevard. All very, very valuable experiences. And I'm also equally enjoying teaching people how to do that, grow food, and then how to preserve that food so that we will be more food secure right at home, at the grassroots, right where we start. Because if we're secure in our food, ourselves, our families, then we can help the rest of our communities in times of necessary times.
Thanks, Linda. I was Linda's neighbor for a while, so I can attest to what she and Dave have done on their property, and it's pretty outstanding, and she's right in the fact that it's a great way to get to know your neighbors and really get to know your community. I mean, there's a multitude of reasons at why it's great to grow on your own property and raise chickens, and I have chickens myself, and it's been unreal just being able to go out to the coop in the morning, and I was making a cake the other day and I needed eggs, and I'm like, oh, we have eggs in the chicken coop right now. And so I managed to go and get one, was able to finish making my cake. I mean, there's a number of health reasons, too. It's great exercise. You're also eating really fantastic food. And I think that that's probably the number one reason why I grow food, is just it tastes so much better than what you're generally getting from the grocery store. There's that skills knowledge, too, that you're developing. So not only preservation knowledges, but in terms of potential food shortages, you know how to preserve your own food and grow your own food, which is very valuable. There's a number of environmental benefits too. So you're reducing your environmental impact because there's less transportation. You're picking and eating what's right out your front door or your back door, and so everything is very close by. There's also that improved biodiversity. So if you are growing food in your yard, then you are contributing to wildlife habitat, and that's fantastic as well. So I could go on and on, but we've got two other panelists that I'll let speak to this as well.
Thank you. I think probably the quality is the number one thing, and of course that's going to keep coming up all the time about that. But I also want to say, because in the introduction it said I'd really rather be in the garden than anywhere else. I don't want to go shopping. I want to be able to go out to the yard and get what I want. Now, that may mean that when your husband says, is there anything else that isn't green that we could have for dinner tonight? But, no, that's the choice. So it really is about the quality. Also, the fact that not everybody has a large area of land. Many people don't even want a lot of land to look after. And so it's really good to learn how to grow on any size lot, in anything. I think it's amazing what can be grown, whether it's microgreens on your windowsill or a bucket on a patio. There's a lot you can grow. And I think there's that whole range. We don't have to think that you have to have a large property in order to have that good quality food. Thanks.
Obviously, the baby liked that answer, yes? Okay. Some of the things I thought I might touch on are on a slightly different nature to the advantages. They can, when you have in your city, say if your official community plan allows for hobby farms, you can start to attract investment, you can start to create jobs in town. So those are some of the things that really can benefit your community as a whole, and not just the people who are going to be growing stuff in their own gardens. Another thing that becomes really important and can be fantastic for your community is a very large cultural component, because as people become more interested in the food that is local and food is native, you very often can start to tap into a lot of the First Nations culture and the type of food that they grow, the way they cook it, etc. So that's something else to think about, and it can be a tremendous educational benefit. And another thing, of course, is everyone talked about the freshness, etc., but you're going to save money, you're going to reduce costs. Hopefully we'll be lowering greenhouse gases, I guess, if we're not keeping too many cows on our property, isn't it? Yeah, it really wakes people up, makes them think a bit about the environment. And all of a sudden, when you're growing stuff in your own garden, you're going to be less likely to use chemicals in your garden and to chuck stuff down down into the sewers that might be harmful. So it really makes people think. Thank you.
So thank you, everybody. We have two. So to pick up on some of those themes, Andrea mentioned in her introduction that since about the 1950s, we've seen food commodified and turned into something that we go to a store or is seen to be taken from a store that we buy. So what are some of the important considerations when reintegrating food back into the urban landscape? Turning the urban landscape from a place where people live with grocery stores to a place where people live and grow. Right. Let's start with Judith then.
I was just, because one of my really strong beliefs is to start small. And I think that's probably what any of you are gardeners who getting really excited and off you go and you're going to dig up all this turf or mulch it in and cover it up. Just start small and get really successful on small scale things and learn, because there's a huge amount to learn. So I guess I would just start small, start where you can and make it easier. You know, don't have too many big ideas to what you do. And then if it fails, you say, well, that didn't work, right? You know, that didn't, you know, I can't grow carrots. I'm not going to do that. So just keep it manageable.
I thought something, I think that we need to start with the education first. I think that there's too much of an idea that it needs to be purchased out of the store and that somehow safer out of the store or better for us out of the store than in the backyard gardens. We need to change perception. And I've really enjoyed letting people come through my garden and talk about certain things and taste the blueberries off the bushes. Because they need that experience. I think there's some experience lacking in growing your own.
And your food is fantastic.
It's just organic. Anybody can do it.
I think, so when I was thinking about this question, with my work with local governments, I kind of wear that hat, and I'm always thinking about what sort of implications or impacts would urban agriculture have on your community. And I always feel like kind of the key thing, apart from starting small, I think starting small is a good, is the important step, but really getting to know your neighbors through that process and getting your neighbors on board. A lot of things are complaint driven when it comes to local governments. So if you have your community and your neighbors on board, then you have some great champions in close to you. So, I mean, there's that. And then just considering your neighbors when you're actually setting up your gardening or your farm or whatever you'd like to call it. And so where are you locating your compost? Where is your manure that you're bringing in located? And what sort of noise might you be generating? Do you have chickens? And maybe roosters are not the best way to go. So, you know, those kinds of considerations. Those are some of the things that ran through my head.
Can you pick up on these themes related to city and community planning? Can you elaborate a little bit more on the considerations that the cities might have to take on, like the city of Courtney or other places in the Comox Valley that might be expanding? What should they look out for?
Let's talk about Cumberland. The whole idea of urban agriculture for Cumberland was totally community-driven, like absolutely. We could get 40 people out for a zoning meeting, or rather, we could get like 10 people out for a zoning meeting, but if we were talking about chickens, we could get 40 people out. You know, so it became Chicken Night was one of our village hall meetings, which was just wonderful. The consultants that we had that worked on the zoning plan and all the staff were totally supportive, but it really was the community. We said, what do you want to see? Now, what's interesting is it is... We haven't had a growing season yet. We just passed the zoning bylaw in September, so we haven't really seen. We need to have a couple of years to find out really what the problems are. The few complaints that I ever had, you know, sort of even previously, or people with concerns about the zoning bylaw, about allowing hens and bees and more urban agriculture and sales off property, were pretty well all related to things, the standard things, rodents. You know, there's going to be rats everywhere, and I had to point out, I think there were already rats in Cumberland before there were ever hens. So so things like that, and a lot of it was just sort of incidental information that somebody just had sort of some idea that it would be a problem. And, of course, in Cumberland, there's been chickens for years, even before the bylaw. The chickens didn't know the bylaw was there, so they were just fine. And as somebody mentioned that about any municipality, we're complaint driven. So if you keep a really tidy coop and you keep everything clean and you don't have roosters, actually we don't allow roosters in the village of Cumberland, and you run a tidy garden and everything like that and keep your manure and compost properly, you know, don't let it become anaerobic and sit there, all those things make it really possible that you'll get total support for doing that. So really for Cumberland, we've made it possible to do all these things and then just get out of the way. I often think as a municipality, that's what you need to do. And let people go ahead and do these things. Are we going to have problems with selling off produce on people's properties? I don't know. I don't expect to. I don't expect it'll be a problem at all. And actually, one of the things that probably, it takes a lot of work. All of you know this. There's nodding going on. It takes a lot. You have to be pretty hardworking and pretty driven to be a gardener producing a lot of food. And so that tends to thin a few people out, I think. I find that.
Some of the things that you do have to think about, you can tell I've been talking to my planning department too much, are things like water supply. You might have environmentally sensitive areas. There's watersheds to be considered. So if you are thinking of expanding your garden and getting into doing a little backyard sales, you might have to start to think about those sort of things. If you are doing some sales, what about parking? Is there space for a few vehicles to draw up? Is that going to annoy your neighbors? You know, are they going to be blocking their exits and entrances? So you got to kind of think about those sort of things. And you might need to start thinking of guidelines for foraging. Things like, do you want people, you know, tromping through your local forests, helping themselves to salal or some other berries or mushrooms, that sort of thing. So those sort of things can be written into bylaws and controlled in different ways. And then there's things like soil type. There's certain areas that are just great for growing some things and not so great for growing others. And, you know, sometimes you can even get into a scale where you might be using waste heat from a semi-industrial process, which can then be used to heat greenhouses and continue to grow produce and make use of that waste heat. So those are a few of the planning oriented. I'm a recreationist, but I talk to planning.
Go. Are you wanting to add something down there?
No, I don't know if I have much to add. I was just going to put another plug for soil testing. Yeah. Big fan of soil testing. I mean, I don't think it's as much of an issue here, but in some of the really urban areas, there are contamination issues. So you may need to consider raised beds as opposed to actually gardening in the ground. And it's just something to keep in mind.
I want to talk a little bit about the complaints, because they've come up a few times already. So in your capacity, in your work, what are some of the key concerns that community members have raised, and how would you address some of those issues?
I haven't had many complaints, as far as I know. But one thing that I wanted to make very certain in a front yard garden is that it is aesthetically pleasing. So my vegetable garden has a lot of flowering shrubs and neat and tidy fences. There isn't a lot of plastic blowing around or anything. I know it's very useful in gardens, but not in the front yard. I do have a little farm stand where I sell produce in the summer, and it's small and not obtrusive, not big, not overbearing, not blocking anyone's vision or view. And same with the fence in the front yard. It's open mesh so that it's not like a solid wall and imposing on people. Parking could be an issue in my location, and I'm not very busy, so luckily there's only one car there at a time. And I think it is very important, though, to be aware of your neighbors and how your neighbors feel about what you are doing there. And so far I've had positive feedback that I know.
From some of my past experiences, definitely traffic and parking, but the one thing that I heard was concerns about compost bins, and so that's why I mentioned it, because I think that's the complaint that I've heard a lot, and not necessarily rodents, although that's a major issue, but odor, and so it's just, managing that very carefully.
It was interesting, a winery who was looking at buying our grapes recently, they were quite surprised. They came to our vineyard and they said, oh, it's so tidy. They said, we thought organic was another word for letting it just be messy. And I just thought, that what a bad sort of rap that was to have that was kind of the free flow, let's let it all you know, go to weeds and everything like that. That was the organic method to do that. So I think you're right in keeping it tidy. That's probably really good marketing on your part. Yeah, important to do that and keeping it tidy and not have let things go to weeds, unless there's a lot of things you do want to go to seed, of course. But, you know, there's a way to do it that can please everybody, I think.
How do people start? How do they start with the, they start small, but what's the first step for you?
It was so long ago. Start very small, I think, and maybe find somebody who's growing themselves, and you get inspired. And you can just start with a few herbs on the windowsill. I think for ourselves, we wanted to save money and feed our children, and there was a lot of soil available at the time, a lot of property available, so that we just kept planting. And probably too large in the first year. Stay small and plant what you're going to eat. There's no point doing the exotic ones or the things that are going to take a lot of effort. And talking to your local gardeners, you'll find out what does take a lot of effort and what doesn't take a lot of effort. So I think that's very valuable in the beginning with starting a new garden. But just start. Everybody should just start. Some seeds in the ground.
Yeah, until I moved back home, back to the Valley, I lived mostly in apartments. So there is a picture that will pop up, I think, of pots. And that's how I started, with pots on my balcony. So herbs and, yeah, things that grew well in pots. And I had terrible, terrible sun exposure. So anything like leafy greens was great. but yeah, that was an easy way to start, because you can get soil in bags and all your inputs are very small. And it was, a relatively good way to get going.
And there are a lot of great groups, like CD, the Seed Savers are wonderful. So there's a great source of people, and of course the library or online, although I'm not a fan of bloggy things. When you find out that somebody's never grown something and has an opinion about it, I really want to avoid those to do that. But I have to come clean as a landscape architect, and I'm really what I consider a good longtime gardener. The very first time I went to Sears in the spring and asked for daffodil bulbs, and this woman was so scathing and so mean to me, and she said, "Dear, you plant daffodils in the fall." And I thought, why would I know that? Why genetically would I know that? Growing up in Vancouver in an urban area in Kerrisdale, why would I know that? So I've come a long way.
Well, one of the ways we've kind of tried to help people get started in gardens is by offering free gardening programs. And they have been tremendously successful. We've done basic things like growing blueberries, which we couldn't cope with the demand on that one. Everyone wanted to grow blueberries. How to start growing vegetables was another one. We're going to be doing beginner seed saving. We had gardening for wildlife. The programs are all free. They're put on in evenings. They last for an hour. We invite people to come down from the community and just join in. And normally we get a lot of experts who come, who are great because they can also talk once you get to the open floor time. So they feed into it. And then you get people that are ranked beginners. You get people that have moved here from totally different climate areas. And so that has been very beneficial. And another workshop that I did in a slightly bigger scale was we did one for how to start a community garden. And that also got a great response. And out of that, we've had a couple of garden ideas are now in the seedling stage. So we're just going to nurture them along.
What other partnerships or supports can be put in place within a community by both the municipality or nonprofit organizations, educational institutions, to support urban agriculture?
Well, there are lots of different options for collaboration and partnerships. I mean, local food organizations like Lush Valley and the city partnership that's already been developed is really key to get these things off the ground. Working in nonprofit capacities in the past, we always had a really, really close relationship to parks departments within the local government, because especially when you're working with community gardens, and they can provide a lot for you, and they're great people to have on your side. And so operations and parks departments. So again, neighbors, somebody that you can share the harvest with and possibly do some collaborative gardening and share the cost of inputs. That's always great too. If you've got somebody and you're getting a big load of manure coming in or bark mulch or whatever, and you can share it with your neighbors, that's always great. And education. So again, partnering with organizations like Lush Valley and other local food organizations or the Bee Club and offering courses on gardening and that kind of thing.
I was going to say that obviously if you can, and once maybe this is moved forward in Courtney Comlock's, if you have support from your planning department and it's built into your official community plan, that's just a tremendous start, because then if someone brings forward a development idea to council, everything's already in place. It's not like they can say, oh no, we don't approve of that. You know, it's already in the plan. I found that doing things like... we have the regional district has a compost education center. They're wonderful to partner with, and they do workshops all the time. We're very lucky to have a very vibrant food hub in Campbell River and the Strathcona Food Network, a couple of the members who are down front here. That has been the contacts and the ideas that come out of that are tremendous. And also the City of Campbell River developed a website called, the title was Think Local, Eat Local. And on there, you could go, you could find out what was grown locally, where there is land available for developing gardens. And that has been put aside by our parks department. They identified fallow land that was park land, but really wasn't being used for much and could potentially be used for a garden. And so that's already been pre-identified. And they also have things like stores and markets that sell local produce. So again, it just encourages people to think about doing everything locally and maybe growing something themselves.
I just want to make a comment about the fact that a lot of people, when they come into the planning department in Cumberland and talk to me, they think that somehow there's bylaws against doing a lot of things. And I actually am surprised. Nobody can stop you from growing vegetables in your yard. Like, nothing. There's no bylaws about that. I have people come to me and say, I wish Cumberland would get rid of the bylaw to stop us from collecting rainwater. There's no bylaw against collecting rainwater. Like, there is a lot of things. Often it's just our own initiative. We need to take more initiative to just do those things and just get out there and try it. So don't use us as an excuse, right? Because it isn't there.
Just to add on to what Linda said too, you reminded me of there was a great partnership that happened in Victoria when I was working down there with the nonprofit that I worked with, and the university, so UVic, and the students at UVic actually did just that. So they did a feasibility study and did on creating a what do they call it? Basically looking into available land within the city and so what was, the brown lands and what was available for gardening. And so they were going to map that, but it was like a feasibility study in order to actually work on that. So I don't know what's happened with it, but I think that they were moving forward with it. But that's a great option too. But there's lots of research opportunities with the local educational centers.
So speaking of other communities, I'm wondering if we've heard from Linda and she's outlined her personal growth and the benefits she's seen with her family. But I'm wondering if you could speak to the specific benefits that you've witnessed in your communities. I know Cumberland's a little newer. Andrea especially has worked with a number of places. So can you elaborate on some of the community gains that we've seen as a consequence of expanding urban agriculture bylaws?
The thing that comes to mind is really that the act of really engaging in urban agriculture, and that developing in a community has taken away a lot of the fear and the potential complaints that result from the concerns over urban agriculture. So places like Victoria, their bylaws are actually probably the most permissive I've seen as far as chickens and beekeeping and sales. We were just talking about that earlier. So Victoria allows on-site sales. So yard stand, I think. Yeah, yard gate or yard stand sales and on-site in residential areas. And it's the only bylaw that I am aware of that does allow that. But I think that that has developed because urban agriculture has been a key aspect of Victoria for a really long time, and they've got some very, very well-established community gardens, and a lot of people grow their own food there, and so I think that those things sort of evolve in through time. But yeah, that's what I can think of off the top of my head.
I was going to add something more, a bit off the topic probably. It was a great farming friend of mine who's an amazing farmer, amazing food producer in the valley. And he said a really important thing to remember is feed yourself first. I think I must have been talking about growing something for sale, and he said feed yourself first. When you've completely are feeding your entire family and you've got everything put aside for the year and the freezer's full and all those nice little butternut squash are sitting there all toasty for the winter, that's when you can start to think about the next stage. Because really, that's important that you're not going out and you're paying. So you might be selling, but what you're getting back, you still have to go out and buy more food. So I think that's a good thing to remember that.
I like that. That is what I'm trying to do, is to feed ourselves first. So there are certain things that we have surplus of, excess of, that I'm selling. It's kale, and then it's some more kale. And we have blueberry bushes, but I'm not selling blueberries. Because we need all that we can get. I have to augment that. So selling excess is wonderful because nothing goes to waste. And I'm helping with the community, and it's local, and people are learning seasonal. That's really important too. Someone asked me for some pickling cucumbers after they were all done. And I went, no, you have to get them earlier. You know, they're only here for a short period of time, so that's an educational thing. Not the same as market gardening, but feeding yourself first on your small piece of property is very beneficial in lots of ways.
Okay, so why don't we end with one final question related to this idea of feeding yourself first. How can we reduce barriers to people feeding themselves? What are some of the key barriers that you've witnessed, and how do we take them down?
It's not that much work. No, I know it's work. Yes, you have to put some time into it, but it's not as overwhelming as I think that people have a perception that it is. There's a lot of ways that we can mulch to keep weeds down, and soaker hoses for watering, timers. There are a lot of things that we can do to make it not nearly as overwhelming as it seems, especially if you start small and see the fruits of your labor. It's not that much work.
From a different perspective, I think maybe distilling some of the myths that everything is, all the bylaws are very restrictive. I think it's a good place to start because there is a lot that you can do already. And I mean, projects like this are hoping to make it even more accessible to people. So they're really educating folks on what is possible is a great place to start.
Can I just intervene for a moment? I was reminded by something that you said of safety considerations. Are safety considerations a barrier?
Which kind of safety considerations?
Well, with urban agriculture, with lifting and weight and building and just all of the safety issues that can arise, are people worried that it's unsafe?
Safety isn't necessarily something that I've heard as a concern. I've heard health benefits of doing all of those things. it depends on how active you are on your property, but I think you would have those same issues if you were going to build a shed or anything like that. I don't know. Have you heard safety, any concerns around that?
I'd say it was an excuse.
Really, like it doesn't... It's as you said, it's such a great health benefit and staying in shape and eating good food that I haven't heard any concerns. I think we've gotten to, and I won't type an age group or anything like that, but we seem to think that you need an expert or somebody needs to show you what to do or that. You mentioned in the introduction about after World War II, when people used to grow food, when families always did grow food, and now we've kind of gotten away from that. And there's nothing very magical or, you know, tricky about it at all. And it is just, as you said, just start small, feed yourself, and then sell the excess kale.
There you go. I think just to sort of reiterate something I said before, you know, offer little workshops, get out there and talk to the community. We have, just like Courtney, we have a CD Sunday coming up on March the 19th. And our planning department is actually coming to the CD Sunday because they realize that might be a really good place to talk to people about gardens and urban hens and all of those issues that people have questions about. So getting out there and talking to the public and making yourself available if you have knowledge is just a super way to encourage folk to get started in gardening.
Would you like to add anything else before we turn the microphone over to the audience for their questions or comments?
Let them have it.
Okay, well, thank you very much for sharing your ideas.